If you're ready now, I think we're going to start our kickoff conversation, innovatively titled this year, not the keynote speech. And if I may, I'll invite Professor Mark Mazower to introduce our speaker for the evening, poet.
Thank you very much. Une constitution forte, une âme ferme et un esprit droit. A strong constitution, a staunch soul, and a noble spirit formed in him the most favorable equilibrium for the empire of reason. He felt that one passion, and this was the love of truth, and after that, a taste for the order of things and justice uniting act and thought. These words, written nearly two centuries ago, seemed apposite to me in introducing our guest tonight, a friend, a prized mentor, and I think our perfect guide to history and action, Paul LeClerc. And they were written, as Paul probably knows, to describe the Abbé Morellet, one of the most long-lasting of the philosophes, and the author of an endlessly fascinating correspondence and an equally fascinating memoir. If you want to find out more about André Morellet, the place to start is the immaculate three-volume set of his letters that appeared with OUP between 1991 and 1996. That Paul LeClerc was one of the editors of these volumes is perhaps not in itself remarkable. The fact that he did this labor of scholarly devotion whilst holding down, as his day job, the presidency of the New York Public Library certainly is quite a day job. And of course, one that he carried off with panache and what David Remnick once called unassuming brilliance for nearly 18 years as president and CEO between 1993 and 2011. In that time, he brought the New York Public Library into the digital age, opened the Cullman Center for Scholars and Writers, which seems to function as a kind of sanctuary for Columbia faculty with sabbatical who don't want to leave New York, moved easily between the world of exhibition curating, fundraising, refurbishing, as many of you will know, in grand style, the main reading room on 42nd Street, transforming, restoring, enriching, and building some of the library's 85 branches, rehoused the Schoenberg Center in a gorgeous new building, bought collections, put the library's resources online, and I could go on and on and on. In other words, if you want an example of history in action, of the historian simultaneously inside and outside the academy, using his skills for the good of society as well as the advancement of learning, I can think of none better than tonight's guest. So in brief, here's the trajectory, salutary and intimidating, I would say, to our cohorts of grad students. Paul was enrolled in the grad program here in French in the fall of 1964. And because things were a little different in those days, he went on the job market in the spring of his second year. And at the age of 25, started on a tenure track position at Union College. And I now know why you received the Dean's Award for Distinguished Achievement from GSAS, because you finished a PhD in 5 years. After spending 13 years at Union, Paul started an administrative career that included 14 years at City University, the last five of these at President Hunter College, and then to the New York Public Library, and since 2012, we've been fortunate at Columbia to have him back with us helping. He has 11 honorary doctorates, the French Legion d'Honneur, and as I've mentioned, the Dean's Award from GSAS as well. It's a great pleasure to welcome to you tonight, Paul LeClerc. Thank you.
Mark, I have to say that being at Columbia has been a joy for me, and by extension to my wife Judith Ginsburg. But one of the things that makes working here, and I've never worked here before, I was just a paying graduate student, there was no tuition assistance in those days. But one of the great joys of working here is having Mark Mazower as my colleague and increasingly as my friend. He is a treasure. And I have to say, I love the history department. I'm close to a number of people within this department. And working with Mark, but especially with Mark and all kinds of things relative to the Global Center that the university has in Paris, Rue Hall, has been deeply, deeply rewarding to me. And this is a relationship, a friendship, and a colleagueship that I cherish very, very much. And so thank you for such an elegant introduction to my part.
Well, if I may, before we start throwing questions at you, we would really like to thank you very much for agreeing to be here with us tonight. And for more than that, I think for suggesting that we have this as a conversation instead of a speech, because I really think that kind of captures the spirit of our conference, which, as we put out in our website as well, is something that we hope is a conversation with publics outside academia. So it's not just about what we as scholars can take to these publics, but what these publics can bring to us. So in that spirit, before we dive straight into your career and the different aspects of it that we find particularly intriguing, I thought if you would perhaps like to reflect on this career map, which over so many decades has sort of gone from being a university professor to a university administrator to the president of the New York Public Library and now to working with Columbia's global program. Today, standing here now, do you still consider yourself a scholar of the French Enlightenment?
Yes. I think that if you were to wake me up at 3 o'clock in the morning, I weren't already awake, but if you were just to shake me and say, who are you? I might answer that in a somewhat complicated kind of way and list several elements, one of them being the husband and the father, but certainly in the short list would be being what we call in French, there's somebody who studies the French in the 18th century in general and in the French 18th century. So it depends on all, but the word being a scholar has to have at least for me some flexibility attached to it, because at this point, if it necessarily means researching and writing, no, I'm not doing that now. If it means reading with a point towards a new book at some time in my life, yes, I'm doing that. It means thinking a lot about certain parts of my field. Yes, I'm doing that. So, and I think that in very large measure is due to the training that I had here at Columbia with some really fabulous people who left their imprint on me in very direct kinds of ways and who shaped my whole way of looking at the life.
Let me draw from that and try to explain why I'm asking this. So, referring to something that Professor Mazower said in his introduction, and with this quote that I have from one of your colleagues, who says, Paul's day job involves grittier tasks, the not so gritty task being fundraising, gaming. He has to do battle over budgets with all the shock troops in the city administration. He meets regularly with councilmen. He arm wrestles with state senators. He twists arms in Washington. Where does this Paul meet the Paul who studies and is inspired by and is interested in Voltaire and the French Enlightenment? What does that education do for this person?
Well, there are two parts to an answer to that question. The first has to do with the organization that you're selling, because one of the jobs or the functions of the person who is the president of the university, the president of library, the museum, whatever it happens to be, that person de facto today is selling that institution to a variety of different kinds of constituents, and very often, indeed most often, asking people within those constituencies to give money to support the institution, to help it grow, expand, change, evolve, and so forth. And so, although few people know this, the president of the New York Public Library is a registered lobbyist in New York, in Washington, and in Albany, and has to have very close relationships with 21 city council members, with 3 borough presidents, that's New York Public Library, that's all the libraries in the town of Staten Island, with the city council speaker, with the mayor's office, with the representatives of Manhattan, Bronx, and Staten Island in the state legislature, both in the assembly as well as in the Senate, the governor's office, and then with those who represent these 3 boroughs in the House of Representatives, and the 2 senators, of course. So there's a whole big, big network and sphere of relationships that have to be personal at a certain level, especially the closer you get to individual libraries, because every council member from Manhattan, Bronx, and Staten Island has between 3 and 5 or maybe even 6 libraries in his or her district. And if those libraries need a new roof, if they need an elevator, if they need monies for ADA compliance and so on and so forth, that has to come from that individual council member's budget. So you've got to be very, very close to those kinds of people. So selling is one part of it, but the other part is selling a mission, selling what the place does for people. And what the New York Public Library, or really any public library, certainly in America, does for people is simply exceptionally important to this being a democratic society, and continuing to be a democratic society, because it's basically free access to all the information that you want, without any questions asked, and for no fee to be paid. And that, to me, is a consequence of the European and the American Enlightenments, and their views towards the place of knowledge, the place of information, the place of access to information in an open society. So the advantage that I had at being at the library is that it was a great story to tell. You give the library money, it will help people. And it doesn't get better than that. So I loved it, I really did. I sort of cut my teeth in dealing with elected officials when I was at the City University, because that's why I'm chair then. As we all know, public higher education in America is less than what's funded by the public sector, as much as United States than it used to be. In the good old days, this entire city university system was free, totally free, and people who got the books were free. And then that all changed during the 1970s. But in any case, selling a place like the New York Public Library was something that I simply loved doing, because the purpose of the library meant so much to me politically, ideologically, personally, conceptually, abstractly, and in the concrete as well. Because you have to go into the reading rooms of 90 different libraries in these 3 rows and see children benefiting from open access in the afternoons after school, senior citizens being there in the morning instead of being home alone. Researchers at the Schomburg, at the Library for Performing Arts, and building 42nd Street. So it was a good way.
Just to come back to your time at Hunter College, how did you understand your responsibility as a university president? What did the university owe the city?
Well, the university owed the city an educated citizenry. What attracted me to the City University, I mean, Union was a great place for me. I met Judith at Union. I took that job for a variety of reasons, one of which was that I wanted to be out of New York, believe it or not. I wanted to be in a liberal arts college. And what was compelling about the offer, there were lots of jobs then. I mean, that was the remarkable thing in 1965. I even had a job offer for a tenure-track position without an interview at the University of Vermont. That's how desperate people were in those positions in a lot of different fields, sort of in mind. So what was attractive about the Union offer was that they said, if you take this job, you'll have the Bigelow Collection all to yourself. I said, what's the Bigelow Collection? Well, it's a collection put together by somebody named Bigelow of great editions of 18th century French writers. And 2 entire sets of Diderot and D'Alembert's great encyclopedia. It was a magnificent edition, I mean, a magnificent collection. But then the magic of the whole thing was that the librarians at Liberal Arts College built around it an entire doctoral level monographic and serials set of collections, so that I had an office in the Humanities Center, but I also had an office in the library with a window, and I had this fabulous collection to myself. So I wrote 85% of the dissertation for Columbia out of that undergraduate college library. And what was the question?
I wanted to get you to Hunter.
So Union was very comfortable for 13 years. I directed trips abroad twice. Judith did as well in Spain and Latin America. I had all the books that I ever published started off there. Then the Vietnam era came, the turbulence of the late 60s and the 70s, and at a certain point I decided that I wanted to be in the emergency system that matched my own emerging political consciousness at that time, and I wanted not to be in a place that catered so predominantly to people of privilege, students of privilege, but to be in a place that cared for what the City University cares for. That was a historically disadvantage. And so I gave up tenure, and I got a job off the first and gave up tenure and became the university dean of the central office of the CUNY system, a dean for academic programs cutting across the entire system. And that was in 1979, but it was only 5 years after the fiscal crisis of 75, 76, and after the very controversial, but very interesting at the same time, program of open admissions to the whole university system. Which would be brought right to life at some point. And so I wanted to be in a big public university in this city, obviously, that's primary mission was to provide high quality, low cost, higher educational opportunity to immigrants, to children of immigrants, historically disadvantaged, and whose fundamental ethos in that way matched my own very, very directly, in a deeply meaning, personal kind of way. So, and when I left UNI, my objective was to become a college president. It was rather modest, I was 38 years old, but that's what I wanted to do. And so I did that, the first job in the CUNY headquarters for 5 years, then became provost of Baruch College for four, and then at Hunter for five and a half.
And how did you see yourself or understand yourself fitting into that broader mission?
Easily. I believe in what the university stood for, and I thought I could contribute to it. And I wasn't terribly conscious of the strategy or the tactics that I really was in effect using throughout my career since then. But now as I look back upon it, the tactic that evolved had to do primarily with getting information into people's hands. And that continued right through the library, obviously. But the first way in which I sought to do that at the City University was really potentially very, very provocative. Indeed, it was provocative with a lot of people. CUNY has two sets of campuses, community colleges and senior colleges and the graduate center as well. And students who were trying to transfer from the community colleges into the senior colleges almost inevitably could not have the credits they took in the community colleges count towards their major in the senior colleges, which meant that they had to take not 4 years to get a BA, they would have to take 5, 6, and 7 years because they had to accumulate so many new credits in the senior college system. So I thought, well, we have to do something about this, and what we have to do is to inform community college students how their credits could be marketed within the senior college systems, colleges. That meant getting all of their courses evaluated by all the relevant academic departments in all of the senior colleges. So let's take history. So if you took history at Bronx Community College, what would the history faculties of Hunter, Queens College, Brooklyn College, City College, Lehman, the College of Staten Island, and so on, think of those courses? Would they count them towards the major, or would they just say, nice, but you've got to do the Civil War over with us, because ours is a much better course than the Civil War than yours was. Now this was this was probably 1980 or 81, and people were just starting to get big clubbing computers in their office, but what we did was to have all the senior college faculties look at all the liberal arts and sciences courses, taking all the community colleges in their entirety to create a vast database of that. It was called the City University Course Equivalency Guide, and then publish that so students could actually shop their
under Purdue, preliminary junior college undergraduate work into the senior college system, and therefore become consumers, and in fact, get out more quickly. And they would be informed. And the Ford Foundation Lend Book, that was the first grant I ever got. That was $20,000. And believe me, a lot of the presidents within the university system were not at all happy with this. But it was really worth doing. So it was caring for students in a way, and enfranchising them with information that they could then use to better their own lives.
Is that, we know from your career, you left Hunter College, you went to the New York Public Library. Can you talk a little bit about what it was that attracted you to the New York Public Library? Did you say that you only came to your realization of your calling for disseminating information post facto? Was that the draw?
No, the New York Public Library, we've all used it, right? I mean, everybody knows it, uses it, loves it. And I used it as a on multiple occasions when I was high school, in college, and even when I was here as a graduate student, and even when I was at Hunter, working on the last book that I did. But you can't aspire to being the president of the New York Public Library. And I mean, you can, but you'd be sort of psychotic if you did. That's a job that comes up, you know, maybe once every 10 to 15 to 20 years. But I was what the French would call a rat de bibliothèque, a library rat, doesn't sound so elegant in English, but sort of a library bibliothèque for most of my life. I mean, all the research I did was all based on documents of libraries here and abroad, and I really discovered libraries when I went to high school, because there wasn't any in my neighborhood when I was growing up in Queens, but I was in a brand new boys' Catholic high school in Flushing, and the library became sort of my home away from home in many ways. And the first committee that I got on when I was a young instructor at Union was the library committee, and I was a selector for my department. And at one point, I remember seeing on the bulletin board of the library a special program that the University of Michigan was sponsoring for people with PhDs in humanities who wished to get degrees in library science. And I thought about it for a few weeks. I mean, I love libraries that much. And I spent every summer I was a reader at the Bibliothèque Nationale. So libraries were just a major, major part of my whole existence. And the chance of running a New York Public Library was just too great to even think of. When I was a young instructor at Union, in my second year, I was walking across the campus with a colleague of mine, and he said, "You see that kid over there?" I said, "Yeah, he's in one of my classes." He said, "His father is the president of the New York Public Library." I said, "Oh my God, thank you. Just teaching the son of the president of the New York Public Library representing PhD." But I have to say, getting that job was easier than any other job I've ever gotten in my life. It really was. I mean, the interview for Hunter was excruciating. It went on for very public, obviously, as those things are these days, and it went on for, it felt like 18 hours. And I had dinner with the faculty members that night after this long day that began at 7:30 in the morning or so. And I saw a political scientist asked me, "Now, if the Board of Trustees came up with a policy that you didn't approve of, would you denounce it to the New York Times?" I know. Sort of both surreal and naive. So I got that job and I loved it. And then for the library job, it was a 1-hour interview with the chairman and the past chairman. And then we went away on summer vacation for a month to Europe. And I came back and had a breakfast meeting with the search committee, and that was it. So it felt like a great golden apple that fell into my lap. It was really a very lucky moment for me.
So one of the things that you did at the library was to become very involved in the exhibitions, these planning of exhibitions. And Tanya's going to have a bunch more questions for you about some of the other things you did there, but I did want to ask you, some of these exhibitions turned out to be unbelievably successful, this exhibition on Utopia, for example. And I, with some distance and some time, I wonder if you might reflect a little bit about what you think attracted people to these exhibitions. And not just in New York, the exhibition was picked up in Paris, it traveled. What is it that people saw in this sort of historical collection that you helped curate or put together? What sort of a need were you fulfilling?
Well, there were two.
One was, I wanted to send a very direct signal to the curatorial staff, the general staff of the library, that I cared about what they did, and I cared about the collections. Just as when I was at Hunter, I wanted to send a signal to the faculty that I cared about teaching and research, and so I taught almost every semester at Hunter. So when I got to the library, I said, well, how can I send the signal in a way that's meaningful and that will be read in the way that I want it to be read? And so I couldn't start going and building collections right off the bat, or selecting materials for them. But I knew that the library had an important exhibit program, and I said, well, why don't I organize an exhibit and see what we have and see if that will work, and see if that will be something that will be good for the library, good for the public, and will send the signal that I wanted to send. So I started thinking about my field and the writers that I like, and if there are any kinds of centennials or anniversary dates of any consequence coming up. There were none for Voltaire. There was just before I left, and so I put together an exhibit on Candide to celebrate the 250th anniversary of his publication, which was the last one I had my hand in. But there was for La Fontaine, the great poet and the great writer of fables. So so we organized an exhibit, and I hired two young people to help with it. One of them, a PhD candidate in history at the McKinney Graduate School, and gave them all the credit. I mean, I was the curator. They got great stuff for their resume by organizing the exhibit. And lo and behold, it got two half-page reviews in the New York Times, positive. I mean, thank God they were good, otherwise I wouldn't have a job. So that was one of the motivations. The other one was some advice that I got from Brooke Astor, who invited me to have tea with her when I joined the library, and she said something really, really exceptional. She said, Paul, have fun at the library. Now, no one ever told me to have fun at the job. Has anybody ever told me you to have a good job? She did, and that was her whole sort of MO. And I said, this is a great idea. So I wanted to do these two things, and they came together in this notion of if not actually curating, just saying, let's do an exhibit on, and then finding the right people to make that happen, and giving them all the credit. And it turned out to be something that worked superbly well. And it had to do, I think, in part with the subjects that we chose. That's the thing, you can do an exhibit that nobody's going to care about, but if you've got some good instincts and some good leads, then I think you'll get good press, you'll get good audiences, and you'll make a difference. But what was also important in these was to reveal the richness and the depths of the great collections of the New York Public Library. That was very, very much on my mind, because this is one of the five greatest libraries in the world with staggering collections. Finally, I said, you could do an exhibit on cornflakes here, and it'd be great, because you get, so for La Fontaine, we had everything imaginable. I mean, we had menus with the illustration of La Fontaine's fables from the SS France. We had a book printed in shorthand during the French Revolution, because for these bizarre reasons, it's a shorthand collection at the New York Public Library. So La Fontaine's fables in shorthand. We had musical scores that were inspired by La Fontaine's fables. We had still images from the Performing Arts Library of dances that were choreographed to inspired by Love Women's Fables. Great illustrated books, fabulous illustrated books, Calder, I mean, everybody of any consequence it seems illustrated. La Fontaine was some extent about it. And then I would go up periodically, since this was all new to me, to see how many people were in the exhibit room and just ask them what they thought of it. And there were great reactions. The bizarrest, however, was from one French woman who told me that every time she had a French governess, and every time she did something bad, like really bad, she had to memorize a fable by La Fontaine. Literature is punishment. So then these exhibits got sort of bigger and more ambitious. And the one Utopia was the most important, I think, of all of them in many different kinds of ways. I wanted to do something with the French National Library, and two great libraries had never merged their collections to do a single exhibit. Museums do that, more or less as a matter of course, but libraries don't. So I suggested to my colleague, the president of the French National Library, if you would consider doing an exhibit with us. I was thinking of Utopia myself because of the great El Dorado episode in Voltaire's Candide, and there's an enormous amount of utopian fiction and the French Enlightenment. I've been working on that research point of view also. And we decided to do one on utopian thought. One of the few ideas that you can trace across most of Western cultural history, from the Hebrew Bible onwards, and from Greek and Roman antiquity onwards, to today. And the exhibit opened first in Paris in January 2000 for the millennium, and then came to New York as well. It was even bigger in New York, and much bigger attendances than in Paris. And this is this monster thing that weighs about 4 kilos, is the French version of the catalog, and I didn't have handy to bring tonight the Oxford University Press published the version that we did, the Oxford Company, the Public Library. And then there was a website, and then I think we have about 17 or 18 other institutions in New York City that were doing things simultaneously with the exhibit in New York. And it was declared an official millennial event by the French government in France, and the White House declared it an official U.S. millennial event. And it was immensely satisfying, wonderfully important, I think, consequential in terms of bringing a major, major cluster of thought serving the Western world in all of its ramifications, in terms of not only about abstractions, but also in terms of real things that happen in built environment, in political systems, utopias as well as dystopias, and so on and so forth. And hundreds of thousands of people came to see it. And so it went from taking an idea, matching it up with a key relationship with another great library, fundraising, which is the responsibility. If you have an idea, then you better produce the money because you can't take it out of the general operating budget because then everybody will be terribly unhappy with you. So new things, you know, you better produce money to do it. And the New York versions cost $1 million. It was not a cheap show at all. It took over the entire library, every exhibit space. You may have seen that some of you had something to do on Utopia, and fortunately the Florence School Foundation undertook that in its entirety. So the combination of doing something for the public, highlighting the importance of libraries as repositories of the written records of many women and children across immense stretches of time, all of which are preserved very carefully for people not only now but future centuries to be able to see, and bring them together through expert curatorial staff members for people to see and appreciate while they're up, and then increasingly in online versions and through publications and through courses that we provide as a consequence of that. That turned out to be sort of the best of the best behind all of this. Excuse me, these are very long answers, I'm sorry.
But that's the idea, though. We want you to reflect and land on a very long career, in which I think the thing that strikes me the most is the public in your life and who the publics are and where the publics are. And since you talk about this enlightenment ideal that inspires you to put information into people's hands, and I keep wondering what that means. And in your work particularly, there are two things that I would like you to sort of talk about. One is opening up the library to the world of the internet. I mean, when you came to your position, apparently the New York Public Library did not even have a website. And now I, as a scholar of South Asia, can sit in my room and find resources that are useful for me. So there is a question of expanding access through the internet. And on the other hand, expanding access locally by opening and renovating several neighborhood libraries, right, where different kinds of people, non-scholars, go
into
the library.
Well, you said it better than I can, probably. It's not that we were behind the curveball in not having a website. Nobody had a website. That was the kind of magic of the time that I got to the library, because then people were talking about the information age. Nobody said the digital age. And so I started the library in December 1993, and so we created the website relatively soon thereafter. I think it might have gone up in 94, 95. And our whole agenda then was to liberate the collections. And now most libraries are very selfish places. I don't think the librarians are selfish, but historically and even today, most libraries are closed to the public. Certainly most great libraries are closed to the public. In fact, there's only one really great library in the world, maybe ever, that's open to anyone, ever. It's only 100 years old or so. But there's only one truly great universal collection that anyone can have access to, and that's in the public library. And what nobody knows is it's a private library. It's privately funded. That is, the research libraries are not the branches. And they're there for, I mean, you can get off a plane from anywhere in the world and go up the steps and for the research collections, you need to have a card that sees it again, and there's no fee to pay. But I remember knocking myself out of the DNF, justifying my reason to see some of the collections. It used to be that you needed letters of introduction for the British Library as well. British Library you have to pay for. I mean, I love the place, I'm not criticizing. It's just a whole different value system that's in place within many of the national libraries in Europe. So here you have a place that's at the level of the British Library, the French National Library, in terms of scale of collections and diversity. But they're there for anyone to see, which is, you know, that relates to something that Franklin supposedly, that Jefferson supposedly said, maybe he did, maybe he didn't, that information is the currency of democracy. But that's the whole ethos of the New York Library. And so opening those up, those collections up, not only in terms of physical access to them, but in terms of virtual access to them through the web, became something that we invested in very, very deeply and very, very seriously and very deliberately. So we were proud that the New York Public Library was the only public library, one of the five founding libraries with Google, the Google Library Project. Controversial to some, but we all really depend a lot on it now. I remember going around giving lots of speeches before Google came along, before search engines came along, saying that there'll never be enough money to put the content of the great library online because it's going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars, and I felt lucky to get $10 million to put the catalogs online. And then one day, this was like a movie scene, one day this guy came into my office with nice trousers, no jacket, no tie, a nice shirt, and he said, "Hi, I'm so-and-so from Google, and we want to scan the entire library's collections." It was just astonishing. And I said, "Are you kidding?" And he wasn't. And judging from his email address, he was one of the early people at Google, so he must be immensely wealthy at this point. So we thought a lot about it, but we ultimately decided that it would be very good for our public to put free of copyright material from the library's collections online to Google. But before that, this is important to know, before that we placed a big bet on opening the collections of the library to the web with a very large gift that we got from the foundation. It was $8 million. And I said to the Mellon director of the library, "Let's put this into digitization of collections." And he said, "Okay, but let's not do text, let's do images," which is brilliant on this part. So we created something that's called the New Public Library Digital Gallery. And I think the initial objective was to scan 1 million images, all free of copyright, in a big searchable database. And when I left, which was 4 years this June, at the time that I left, there were each month between 10 and 12.5 million downloads from the library's digital gallery. So that's 120 million a year, minimally, from that collection alone. Which means that we instantly, once this worked, once it got up, we acquired a global audience. And so within very little time, we became the second most heavily library website in the world, most heavily used library website in the world, only after the Library of Congress. But that's not an exact comparison because all pending legislation in Congress is put on their website, something called Jefferson. And we became the biggest, the most popular website of any cultural organization in the town, many museums and so on and so forth. So it was all part of the same sort of basic philosophy of the library, to put it all out there for the people. And then in terms of facilities, one of the things I cared the most about having taken place when I was there was that we built a new $50 million, 70,000 square foot new central library for the borough of the Bronx. And within its first year, it had close to 1 million visitors. And the vast majority of those visitors were from the African American and Latino communities of the Bronx. It became the most successful library for those groups of any city in the United States. And a special place for teens, it became the hangout, for Latino goth teenagers who worked there with a writing coach, and they put their journals online. And we had these hip young librarians to work with teenagers. We still do. Shouldn't say we anymore. At that time we did. I'm sure they're still there. Plus, a special program where people who needed proficiency, increasing their proficiency in written and spoken English as a second language, free tutorials for them, free job placement advice, a job placement coach, a person who told people how to dress for an interview, help them search for jobs online, I mean, everything imaginable, free wireless, free laptops to use, at your place, all the desktops and computers were being taken. Open 7 days a week, 12 hours a day. It was just great, just great. So, what about that? So it was buildings, it was facilities, it was a well-trained staff, it was a whole approach towards making people feel welcome and comfortable in the library, towards finding out what they wanted and giving it to them. And there was one policy that changed as a consequence of this, and that was the kind of books that were put in the branches. Because we had a generation of librarians, for instance, who thought that Disney children's books weren't good enough. We said, well, let's try putting some out, or they flew off the shelves. So we decided that we really ought to find out, by neighborhood, what things people wanted in their libraries, and then find them so they could have them. And within a relatively short period of time after that new philosophy of acquisitions and collection building went into place, the New Public became the largest circulating library in America. So it was a bit, that change of policy was traumatic for some of the professionals on the staff, but it was a very, very necessary thing to do.
You're echoing some of what we heard at the panel before this about the need when we're thinking about the role of culture in communities to listen to the communities. You've had an opportunity to be in a number of different cultural institutions, from Hunter to the New York Public Library, now the Global Center. And as we're wrapping up this conversation, I wonder if I could ask you to sort of take a step to the side of your work and think, okay, having been in these institutions, having seen the sorts of services they're providing to the public, what are the places that are absent? What are the gaps? What are the places where our cultural institutions aren't reaching the publics, or where there is a need among the public or something that we should be looking to our cultural institutions to do, but that they're not doing?
Well, you can never do enough outreach to underserved communities and populations. You just can't. I'm involved with the Getty in LA as a trustee, and one of the things that we're increasingly doing there is spending money on a busing program to bring kids in from school districts in the LA region so that they can experience that place and its riches, and learn from the educational experts on staff at the Getty. One of the things that I learned was that when you build a building, it's very easy to send the wrong signals to the people you want to have commit to it and use it. And there's a kind of anthropology, a sociology that you've got to be mindful of when you're talking to the architects that you use, because they can do the wrong thing. And subliminally, they will send messages potentially to patrons that this place didn't have them in mind when it was built. I learned that first when we were redoing libraries in Chinatown, because we got good advice, and that was that we should use red color and flooring, because that, to that community, meant a whole lot of things, a particular happiness and good feelings about being there. But we did this library in the Bronx, which is really a very, very significant piece of architecture. The lead architect on it was a devotee of the Bauhaus. And when it came to time to think about the interiors, I said, what colors are you going to use? And he said, well, white, black, gray, and red. And I said, you can't. I said, that's a Northern European aesthetic. The last, it was 100 years ago then, but let's say 5 years ago. And this community is made of people from the Caribbean, from Africa, from a whole different world in terms of color. So I said, we're not going to do the color. And we brought in a color consultant who chose these gorgeous colors, greens and blues and oranges and things like that. And so when people walked in, there was no question that this is the place for them, because it reflected the kind of cultural aesthetic that they were used to from where they were born, kinds of places that they lived in or because they lived in, and so on and so forth. So sometimes being in these positions requires that you think of it out of the box and have as much sensitivity as you possibly can, or you hire people to have the sensitivity that's needed so that when you do something, it's going to be accepted and welcomed. And the building at Fifth Avenue is a problem because it is so grandiose. And people, a lot of us, the first time we walked in here, say, oh, this is nice, but it's not for me. Where are the books? Now, it's perhaps sort of one of the greatest Beaux-Arts buildings in the United States. Some would say the greatest. But it can be very, very awful. And so to make it warm and welcoming to people who aren't used to being in that kind of grandiose space with those materials and so on and so forth, is something that has to be deliberately thought through, and to need new approaches to letting people know that this is for them. This isn't necessarily for certain kinds of people, it's for everybody. So if Astor Hall isn't something that you can feel good about, go downstairs. And there are other kinds of places that are more warm and comfortable for you. In some ways, it's what's happened here at Butler. When the university decided, smart enough, to make environments comfortable for students to be in, with lounge seating and all the rest of it, instead of the standard kind of thing that was there when I was there in the 1960s or so. So one has to believe 100% that the people, either at, let's say, the City University or at Columbia, or the people who live in the Bronx or in an impoverished neighborhood in Staten Island, that they have a right to be in a place that is supportive of their aspirations, and that they need a staff there that's going to be respectful of them. They need to have access to the kinds of things that they need to better themselves, their lives, their children's lives, their parents' lives, what have you. And your job as an administrator is to do everything you can to force that to happen for them, because they're the future. And if that means that you infuse it with high-end exhibits like this one or one of the new Putnam Revolution that I'm very proud of, that's doing the right kind of work. But one of the nice things that Tony Grafton said about these exhibits and the reviews that he wrote in the New York Review of Books was that they're solid, they're open, they don't condescend to people, but they make abstract thought, in the case of utopia and utopian physics, I'd say, they make them accessible and understandable. And then what you can do is build around them. You use educational programs that are aimed at youngsters, at teenagers, at university students, and so on and so forth. So it becomes a big mix of things. But fundamentally, what you need to make it all happen is not your ideas necessarily, not like the beginning of it, but you need money, and sometimes a lot of it, and you need a great staff. And then it can happen. And I was blessed in my time, at various points of my career, that I was able to raise as much money as it took, and that I had phenomenal people to work with to make it happen.
Well, on that note, I think we should open it up to the floor for questions. We don't have a whole lot of time, but we do have some time. So if you have any questions, please.
So this is a library question. It's a true story that I'd like you to react to. So the provost of my university, George Washington University of Washington, D.C., who's an engineer, had his faculty over to dinner every once in a while. He told a story at this dinner in which he said that his daughter, who he was very proud of, was a professor of political science at Princeton, got a call from her dean. And the dean said, I'd like you to serve on the library committee. And the daughter said, sure, I'll do that, but I have to tell you, I've been here 3 years now, I've never been in the library. You know, all my work is on databases. So is that scary or not?
Well, no. I mean, yes, it can be scary if your provost thinks that that's a great answer, and then, well, you don't need a library. Now, to be sure, an enormous amount of printed material is on the web. I use it myself. I mean, I can now access Diderot and D'Alembert's encyclopedia of open text and the plates at home at 2 in the morning. And I love being able to do that. And I can print it and all the rest. And I can access more information than I ever thought was conceivable to exist very, very easily. So we all do that. We depend on it. At the same time, that's only printed books. So if you're an historian, you care about documents. And you have to remember that in a big library, even in your public, let's say it has 60 million items, 65, 70 million items. Of those, only 15 million were books. And that's true of every great library. So books make up only a small portion of the library's collection. We had 5 million photographs. You think somebody's going to pay to have 5 million photographs digitized? Well, never. Some guy comes along with that, I think came from Google. Zillions of manuscripts and all kinds of other things that might be ephemera. So these libraries will never, ever, ever be all online. I think during any of our lifetimes, I can say that with high level of assurance. Are the physical collections being used less? Yes, they are. I think anybody in the library business who would say that page in the books is at the same level that it used to be 10 years ago, is not something that's true. Does that mean that they're not necessary anymore? No, quite the contrary. Because you can't have access to copyrighted material online unless the author lets that be scanned and lets it be up here for free. Many of them are reluctant to do that. And today we have to remember that there are more books being printed than ever before in human history in all different kinds of languages on paper. So the publishing industry, or the world of publishing, gets bigger and bigger, maybe less profitable, but certainly bigger and bigger. And everybody wants his or her book published, or the physical artifact out there. So libraries are still necessary places for those books to be acquired, and to be housed, and preserved, and for them to be made available and accessible to readers. Doesn't mean that they've got to be 30 minutes away, it might be 24 hours away. I know this is being videotaped, so I'm being judicious in the kinds of adjectives that I use to describe people who think that libraries aren't necessary. But you can imagine what some of those adjectives might be. And I wouldn't want anyone to be sort of a philistine, let's say, in the sake of these great cultural organizations, the oldest in human history. I mean, there's no cultural organization of any kind that's as old as libraries, so I think about 5,000 years, you know, ancient Mesopotamia. And they've always been the first to adapt to new technologies and new ways of running their business. So obviously I'm a passionate advocate for them. Obviously I think they are deeply important. And I think all university administrators should support them. Acknowledge that they're different from what they were. That's okay. We all appreciate what's online. We all appreciate the value of proprietary databases. We all exploit them. But it doesn't mean that the library as a physical location isn't important as well. For public libraries, they have never been used as heavily as they are now. The more public library is open, the more it will be used. There was a very important study that was done. About 6 years ago, funded by the Gates Foundation and executed by researchers at Washington University in Seattle, that measured how Americans use public libraries today. For some strange reason, there was no press coverage ever of this report. It was like a couple of hundred pages. The takeaway was that in the year that the survey took place, so let's say that was 6 years ago, something like close to 70% of all Americans used a public library to be online at some point in that year. I think it was 70% of Americans over 14. Because some people live in a world where they have easy access to the web. Everybody they know has easy access to the web. But they don't realize that there are a lot of poor people in this country, a lot of poor people in this city, that don't have Wi-Fi at home, that don't have a computer hooked necessarily at home, and the library is the only place they're going to use it, or it's, even if there is something at home, it's the better place to use it because they have trained staff who can help them do their searches. So I wrote about that in the
I just want to make sure that we can take one more question before we break. So why don't we, if you don't mind, is there one last question before we, is there maybe a graduate student in the department who's open to learn?
I did a piece on the Huffington Post. And you can look it up and then send it to your provost, okay?
Closing, if I don't see a graduate student, I'll call on a raised hand in the back.
So,
I think
we can take both the questions at the same time.
And I'll be sure.
So you first, and then you
next. Okay, it's fascinating. Riveting, compassionate, and also revelatory. I had no idea. I teach at City University. We're going, went through this whole pathway project where they're trying to consolidate, putting courses, putting 4.4 credit courses into 3 credits, lab, getting rid of the lab and science so it's not convertible to an institution outside of CUNY. What happened? Because we're sort of cut off when you're saying in 1980-81, all the senior colleges and the community colleges were working on this course equivalency guide. I'd love to see that. But it left a lot of presidents unhappy. And we move to the next question. What's the punchline? Okay, definitely.
Why would you have all the questions at one time?
When he came to the New York Public Library, what were the needs for the special Carnegie libraries? What did you have to do to preserve them?
Well, I just want to ask, you know, the difficulties of financing a marvelous institution like the public libraries. For example, the tough decisions to sell Don Allen, the controversy over Mid-Manhattan. I don't have to mention, of course, the controversy of what happened at 42nd Street. The taking of all the volumes and shipping them out to Princeton, which, of course, is another controversy. Friends of mine work in the public library system in the Bronx. It's a daycare center in the middle of the afternoon, and it raises questions about how we're using this space with lack of resources, because here we have all these kids, they're being babysitted by librarians, that's what really goes on, and yet there's all these amazing opportunities for public education which lack the resources of. So I just wondered, you know, I realize those are toughies, but, you know, people in New York are aware of these things that have come to take the public library to task.
Can I also answer a quick, easier one, which is you have a career as an academic, as a professor, and then you suddenly became an administrator of large institutions. Did you learn on the job?
How hard is that to learn on the job? Or is there a way in which a faculty member actually gradually trains to do something like that?
He's brilliant.
It was questionably hard at first. The 5 years I spent in the CUNY Central Administration were the toughest years of my career in terms of learning curve and politics of the place and scale and all this. The Course Equivalency Guide was published. There should be copies, maybe there are copies in the New York Public Library. It was controversial because for the obvious reasons that have to do with enfranchising a whole lot of young people who could then make the lives of senior college people uncomfortable. But nonetheless, it went through. What was perverse was that it was easier for students to take their credits to Vassar than it was to Hunter or Queens or Brooklyn. That's literally true. There was a whole program to renovate the Carnegie Libraries. Some of them were done before my time, and one, unfortunately, on the 79th Street was sort of stripped out, and a very contemporary design was put in. But we tried to, the St. Agnes branch, which you may have seen on 79th Street, is the best example of a Carnegie renovation, I think. Very, very beautiful gem. But we also had issues with boilers, with ADA compliance, with the elevators. We also had an issue when I first came with custodians and their families living in the apartments above them, because each Carnegie had a custodial space for a person to be in residence. But those were not healthy conditions in which to raise children. So a lot of them were done. I tend to say they were all done. Maybe that's not the case, but a lot of them were done. Yours is a very, very big question, sir. The branch libraries have always been daycare centers in a way. The present chairman of the board of the New York Public Library grew up in the Bronx and was what's called a latchkey child. He was told after school, he was a Russian Jewish immigrant parents, he was told after school to go to the library, and he had, as he says, a key, the apartment key on a string around his neck. And then his parents came and picked him up when they finished work and went home. Still happens today with kids. Is it the best form of daycare? The librarians are not daycare specialists, but it's a safe place for children to be, and there are at least 100,000 children in public libraries every afternoon in New York City. We can talk about the other question later, because it's go way over time.
With that rousing call, what I think is a call for socialized daycare in the United States, I'd like to thank Paul again for